Okay, I don't think there are a lot of people yet, but anyway, this is recorded and it's the first time I try something with Twitch. I'm using OBS, which just crashed when I started it, so I hope that the recording will still be okay. The idea there, I've seen a question on Twitter. Few days ago, about composite keys and GPA. And the question was about composite keys because in GPA, of course, it's easier to map a single colon as a key or as a foreign key. And then people using GPA or building framework around GPA. Prefer to put surrogate keys everywhere, but it has some drawbacks. And this is why GPA Buddy asked this question to know what can be the different reasons to have composite keys and then probably to know if it's good to support it in any cases. So my idea was to give my opinion on this. But I already did it a lot on Twitter, on blogs, on conferences. So my idea was to share that live on Twitch. So I didn't really prepare anything except a few examples to introduce what is a key, a primary key, a surrogate key, and all this because we mix a lot of things at the same time. So before looking at the result of that, I will just throw some ideas about the keys. And if people join live, please say hello in the chat. And if you watch that later, I hope the record is good because it's the first time I'm doing that. First, I will create a few tables and explain what is a key because there are some myths about that. I'm using YugabyteDB just because I'm working at Yugabyte and I'm developer advocate for Yugabyte. But it's the same as what you can do in Postgres because we use the same query layer and anyway, we are open source in the same way. So everything I'm doing there, you can do it on Postgres. And with a bit of changes in the syntax, you can probably do that in other databases. So I'm connecting to my database here where I have the Northwind examples. But I will create my own table. Let me drop because I just tried that before starting the live. And then, what is a key in SQL in relational databases? I start by creating a simple table. So this is a table that I call people. I will put information about people. You know that in relational databases, you match the table to the business entity, and people is a business entity. So I create a table with that. With only my business information, so no surrogate key for the moment and no key actually. I didn't declare any key there. In many databases, you don't need to declare the keys at the create table. You can do that after you have this agility. It's different in NoSQL where the storage will depend on the key and then you have to define the key immediately. So in my people table, I have the first name, the last name, birth date, email, all information attributes that I put in the same table. If it was another business entity, I would have another table, but we will see that later. Okay, and then I can check the information about my table there. I have colons, I have no keys, I have no constraints, I have nothing. Do I need any key? Maybe not. I can query it directly with what I have there. For example, I have different people there. And I don't need a key to query it. Of course, if I don't have an index, it can belong on a large table, but that's a different topic. If I want to query people with my last name, I just get aligned with that. No need for a key to access to the data there. But let's say that I want to do the same for this other guy. I have two records there. And this is the problem. When we do not have a key, we have nothing that ensures that our code will return a unique value. Here, in that case, given my data, I should have query on first name and last name, but maybe you may have also duplicates, and then I'll add the birth date. And this is where you start to get the need to define a key on your data so that your code don't have this complexity to know on what you need to query and maybe refine the search as we would do, for example, for ad hoc queries. So let's create a key and I'm not creating a primary key yet. I'm just adding a unique constraint on the Twitter handle. Here I have the Twitter handle, which is known for some people and not for some others. And by saying that if it's known, it is unique, I know that if I query on the Twitter handle, I have a unique answer. So I can uniquely identify not all people, but the people who are on Twitter, I can uniquely identify them with that. And once I've defined the constraints, this is enforced in the database and I know that. I can also create another key. And this is where I have a composite key. In my people table, I have information about the tax ID, but the tax ID is an ID that is given in each country. So to uniquely identify someone with the tax ID, I need the country code, maybe the ISO code, and the tax ID. And this being unique, I can identify people with that. I will come back on it, but the tax ID looks like a surrogate key, but it's not a surrogate key. It's a business attribute that is defined by the business and exposed to the users. I can also add the constraints on the email. Again, a unique constraints on the email. And I will do something more for this one. I will mention that this email cannot be null. So in addition to being a key, you can define an attribute to be not null. And there you have something that is really similar to a primary key, even if it's not called a primary key. You have something that is unique and that must be known from the beginning, from the first insert, you need to put a value. And then you have something that helps you to reference uniquely a row in the table. And the important thing there, of course, you will probably define that as a primary key if you want it to be the main key. But what I want to show here is that you can have a lot of keys, just define them as unique and not null. And among all those candidate keys that you can use, you can choose one to be the primary key. But the primary key is not a specific business meaning. From the business point of view, you have a lot of different keys. And for the storage of the database, you may have a primary one, and that will depend on the database. For example, here I'm working on YugaByte DB, which stores the rows as documents in LSM index, and then the primary key will be this primary index. If I was on Postgres or Oracle, I store rows in heap tables, and then the organization do not depend on the primary key chosen, except on Oracle if I'm using an index organized table. But all that to say that you have a lot of keys, and then you can choose one to be a primary key. And you can also add additional keys that do not have a business meaning, but that will help you in the data model or make things more simple to reference a row. And this is where we have surrogate keys. And here I'm adding a colon, a people ID, and that will be a surrogate key, which means that I will generate it, but I will not expose it to the user. And that's the thing that is the most important with surrogate keys. For example, I can generate a customer ID, but then it is exposed in on the bill, on the website, and then it's not a surrogate key. It becomes a business key. People use it. A surrogate key should not be exposed outside of the system. It's more a technical address of the row. So I've added the colon, so for the moment everything is null, and I can update it. I'm just using a row number here to put the different numbers on my existing rows. And now I can define that as a primary key, which is exactly the same as defining a unique constraint, not null. The same for the model. For the organization here in behind, I'm on YugaByteDB. The organization will be different. It's reorganized to be stored in the order or with the sharding on the key that is defined there. And I want it to be generated. And this is why I create a sequence, which is already there, but that's not a problem. And then I assign the sequence to the table. Of course, I can define all that in the first create table, but I can do that after. And I start with 4 because I have already 3 people there. So if I look at the definition of my table now with the table definition, I have many keys, some that are defined not null, and some that are defined, one that is defined primary. It seems that the sound is not really good there, and I have no idea how to change that. Let me check if I can reduce the bandwidth. I think I have no idea how to do that. Let me check the settings. I'm new on OBS and I'm new on Twitch, so let's see if I can do something for the should I reduce that? Maybe the video will be a bit worse. We'll see if the sound is better now. Maybe the recording will be okay anyway. So now that I have some keys, the thing that is important also is that an index is created behind. So the key is not only a guarantee that you access to only one row, but also that you have fast access to it thanks to an index. And then I show that with the primary key or with another key, I have the same kind of access there. Here on YugaByte, it is a bit cheaper when I query on the primary key, we don't see it in because they're all index scans, but all rows are stored in the primary key index, so this is why it's a bit cheaper. I don't have a lot of data there. I will insert a few additional rows, 1,000 only. And if we look at the execution plan with the time, we see a small difference there. Okay, so we have defined keys, candidate keys, primary keys. We have a surrogate key there for the country, even if it's not a primary key. And then we will have to define some foreign keys. Let me first add zero there to be able to continue my demo. And now I will create another table. So I have people that I can identify with the tax ID. And I create a new table to store the tax reports. So the tax reports will have information about the tax ID and the country. And a year, we will have one report per year there. Okay, and I will insert some rows there, just one. So for this tax ID, this year, some information about it. And now, did I create the foreign key? I didn't mention it. Yeah. So I want to be sure that a report for 1 year references people in the people table who exist. And this is the other goal of the key. We have seen one goal is to be sure that we identify one row only. The other goal was to create an index in BI and to have fast access to it. And the first goal is to create referential integrity constraints so that we are sure that we cannot insert some related data where the parent row is not there, and this is why I declared the foreign key as tax country and tax ID. And this is important because usually people think that you can have a foreign key that references only the primary key, because this is the default. If I just mention reference people without mentioning the colon, it will try to match the primary key, but any key can be referenced by the foreign key. So it's not mandatory. You can have many keys and all of them can be used for foreign keys. The only problem I have there, so here I referenced a natural key. And this is where I may start to have problem with natural key versus surrogate key. Imagine that now the tax ID changes. I update this guy and his tax ID changes. Things that can happen, but I cannot update it because it is used for the reference. And that's the problem. Using for a reference a value that can change is a problem. And natural keys, business value, may change. If it's technical and not exposed to anyone, you can ensure that it's never changed. But anything that is exposed probably will change one day. Just imagine that you assign a number to people, and then this number, for whatever reason, is a sign of bad luck, and this guy is a VIP and has to change it. Even if you think that it's something that is generated and immutable, there will always be cases where you have to change it. And I cannot update it in the parent table, and I cannot update it in the child table as well. The problem is that I have to update it in both tables at the same time, and that can be quite complex. And this is where it's not very handy to use natural keys, primary or not, for foreign keys. Here I'm adding another foreign key, referencing people. I do not mention the colon, so the default is the primary key with people ID. So finally, I decide that in my tax report, I add a new column that will be used to reference the parent table. And then I have no problem because this value is generated and nobody sees it. So nobody cares about the value. And if nobody cares, nobody will have the idea to change the value one day. And now I can change people ID. It's not a good idea to change the primary key, probably. And it's not a good idea to change the key anyway, but here I can do that in the child table. Because it is the foreign key, so I can reference another one. So here is my tax report. I have two foreign keys. Do I need the two of them? Probably not. And then I drop the first one. And SQL is agile enough to do all that. And in some databases, you can even do that online. I set it as not null in my child table in the tax report. Because the foreign key, you can decide that it has always to be there. And, And this child table adds a foreign key, but no primary key yet. I can define a primary key, and this is where I will start to create compound primary keys, so on multiple columns. Here, I have people ID, which is a surrogate key, but on the parent table. And a year. That will probably not change because if you have a report for a year, you will probably not change the year. So here, the composition of those two columns are probably immutable and can be used as primary key. Of course, I can add a surrogate key, but this is a case where I don't feel the need to do that because the this is already a surrogate key, and the year could also be a surrogate key to another dimension table, for example. So if you have a composite key that is composed only of surrogate keys, you know that it is immutable, and then there is really no need to add another surrogate key just for the easiness to have only one column in it. Okay, so this is my table now, and I think that's all I will show on the command line, just to put some ideas that it's not only primary key versus no key at all. You may have many keys, and one is chosen as a primary key, and it's not about always composite, always not, and it's not the opposite. You can compose natural keys, but you can compose surrogate keys as well. So if we look at the question from GPA Buddy, most of the answers are natural fit for the model. So this is what I tried to explain. Think about the business meaning of it rather than only the technical constraints for the easiness of your framework. So natural fit for the model is a good reason. Memory and performance for using natural keys, for using composite keys, we will look at that later. And for me, the best answer here is from Lucas and the references blog of him on the Juke blog. If you create a table for the association, the many-to-many association between two tables, you already have foreign keys that are surrogate keys, and the primary key in the association table is the composition of the two keys. And there it makes absolutely no sense to create another key. So my first answer, like Lucas mentioned, my first answer is that any framework should be able at least to support composite keys for association tables. If we look at the blog post from Lucas, he takes an example from the Shakila database with actors, films, and there are many actors in a film, and an actor is in many films. So this is a many-to-many relationship, and this is where we create a table that is not a business entity, but a table to materialize this relation. And you have a foreign key on both tables, actor ID there, film ID there, and those are surrogate keys. And you may have a few additional attributes, but the primary key of this one will be actor ID and film ID. Like this, you add a constraint primary key there. And in your navigation, you can navigate in one way or the other way. So probably both will have an index on them, to get fast access through the actor ID and fast access through the film ID. But if you create a surrogate key on that, you will create an additional column, an additional index that will not be used at all in this navigation. And it will probably not be used as a target for a foreign key, because you should not have a foreign key referencing the association table. Here, Lucas mentioned the physical aspect of it. In some databases, the primary key determines the storage. So that's not the case in Postgres. In Postgres, you store everything in heap tables, and on top of it, there are indexes, and one index is the primary key. In Oracle, by default, you have also heap tables, so you don't care about what is the primary key for the physical storage, except if you define the tables as index organized tables. In Yugabyte DB, the primary key is where all the documents are stored. And this is important because Yugabyte is distributed. So there is an automatic sharding on the primary key. And when you create the primary key, you define it as a hash or as a range, depending on what you will do, queries with equalities or inequalities. So here are the explanation about the cost of it when you have an additional index on it, in clustered index, in non-clustered index. And as I mentioned, Oracle, heap table, but you can also have index organized table. Postgres is heap tables only. MySQL, InnoDB is all clustered. SQL Server is by default clustered, but you have the choice. And you can look at that. I will put the link in the chat. I have no idea if the chat goes to the recording or not, but we will see. I will also put the link to this tweet there. Okay, a few people have joined. Please ask if you have any questions, comments on the chat. As I mentioned at the beginning, it's the first time I'm doing something on Twitch, so it's not a prepared presentation. It's just things I wanted to read, talk about, and then I'm doing that live in case people want to interact with it. So there are other reasons there, but basically the main thing is about the association table. And some answers also mentioned that it's not a framework which should constrain your data model. Your data model is there for the business and for the performance, and the framework should support it. Okay. Now, if I'm looking at the chat, but if nothing is there, I don't know if the sound is better now that I reduced the bandwidth of the video. If the sound is still bad, please tell me. And now I will go through. My idea was to do 1 hour maximum for all that. To go through a document that I've written a long time ago. I don't even have an idea. Last edit 2012, where I tried to put together all the reasons for natural key versus surrogate keys, and in the different cases. And then I suggest we look at it together. Probably, I think I've opened it in a public link, which I put in the chat, if I'm able to copy paste it. So it's an old document, and I'm not even sure it's still relevant, and that's the reason I wanted to look at it there, and I'm doing live so that I can comment it. So seems at that time I was still a lot in the theory of logical model, physical models, but people today with the current release cycle unfortunately do not spend a lot of time in the logical design before just starting the prototype. Just about the vocabulary, we say natural key, but think about a business meaning, think about intelligent, think it has a meaning. And we say surrogate key more because it is technical, added only for the platform, for the database, and not exposed to the users. The problem, as soon as you expose a surrogate key, you have many problems. The first one is that you cannot change it, because if I expose, in my example, if I expose the people ID, for example, in the URL, then people will bookmark it, and if for whatever reason I change it, the link has gone. And there is also a security issue with that. If I expose a number for the people ID, people may guess that it is a sequence, and this gives them some information, maybe about the number of customers I have. And even if it's wrong, giving information is always bad. And it's even worse if you give a false information because people think that it's right. And there is also the possibility to generate a UID with no meaning, but the performance may be different. So the idea is that if you generate a surrogate key, do not expose it, keep it internally for your system. So for this example, I was probably working for telco there. I had just a table with calls and phones. And the phone line, so probably like a fixed phone line, had a prefix number and an extension number and a username maybe, but the natural key was prefix and extension. And the calls references the phone because you make calls with a phone, and it adds to the phone information the start of the call. So the idea is that you cannot start two calls at the same time from the same phone. So this can identify a call. And then you have two possibilities for the model. So we have two extremes there. The natural key model, where phone lines have prefix extension as a compound primary key, and the calls have those two columns as foreign key to reference the phone line and add a date, which is probably not a good idea, but there with the idea that if you put a date time, you identify a call from a phone. And the surrogate key model is just having the same information but not using them as a keys. Maybe you can create unique indexes on them, but the primary key will be a generated phone line ID and a generated call ID. And of course, we have a foreign key, phone line ID, to reference the phone line, but we don't use it there in the in the primary key, if we want single colon primary keys. So I've put that as a reminder on the side of the screen there. And we'll look at the ideas I had at this time. So if you want to create the tables, I think I was working with Oracle at that time, so this should work, but the syntax is quite general. Well, yeah, Varchar 2 is Oracle, but you can change it if you want to test it on another database. And the first point I mentioned was efficiency, which was the point there about memory and performance. So, yes, if I want to access to the calls, so a large table, all the calls from the phone company, for example, I want to access to all calls from one phone. So I have the phone number as a prefix and extension, and I query the calls from there. When I have a natural key, I have all information in this table, and I can query it. We can see all information with natural key model. It is there, and I can add index on it. Probably I already have an index because that was the primary key, and those were the first columns in the primary key. So I have an index starting with that. Without any additional index, I can access quickly to the calls from this phone number. With the surrogate key model, that's different. I don't have the phone information directly in the calls. I have to go to the phone lines with the prefix number and extension number, and I will have an additional index on that. And then I access to the phone line ID. Probably I have a unique constraint there so that I'm sure that I have one unique phone line ID for this information. And when I have the phone line ID, I can go to the calls to look at the phone line ID, which is not the key, but is probably also indexed. And then I have all information. And then you can see that you have a join and you have many indexes involved. And that takes time. Well, relational databases are optimized to do joins, so it might be okay. People are going to NoSQL think that joins do not scale. There are possibilities to scale it, but of course, this query will not be as efficient as this one. So if the goal is fast access for the critical query that can be done on one table only, then it's probably better with a natural key. Because the surrogate key, people will not query directly with the surrogate key because you do not expose it. And then you have to query a table and get the surrogate key. So that's about the performance, but of course, it's performance versus agility. So it depends on your tables and the access on your tables. Second point I add here was about changing it, immutability of the key. If I have a user who changes his phone number when the phone number is in the key, we have seen that it's quite difficult. It's not difficult because it is in the primary key. It's difficult because it is referenced by foreign keys. So the idea putting a surrogate key is not just to have another key in the parent table, but it's that it's easier to use it for the tables referencing this table. However, once again, you have to think about the business meaning of it. I have a user, he has a phone, he does a few calls, and then he changes the phone number and is calling again other people. And what do you want from a business point of view to do with the old calls? And this is not a technical choice. Do you think that the calls should belong to the guy with to his new phone. The calls I did last year with another phone are still my calls, and then I must assign them to my new phone? Or do you consider that the calls were done with a phone with a specific number, and if a guy changes the phone number, the new calls will be attached to the new phone number, but the old one will stay with the other one? And this decision, so we have two scenarios, this decision will be completely different with the keys. For example, if I have a natural key model where the phone number is used for the reference, referential integrity, then in the first case, I don't have to update it because the calls done with a phone number stays with the phone number, which means that even if it's a business value that I have there, it is immutable. In the second case, if we want to reassign the calls, we have the same problem as we have seen in the little demo. We have to update everything, and that's really complex. So if from a business meaning you have to reassign the calls to the new phone line, for sure you need a surrogate key. However, think about the data model. If the calls are related to a phone, that's one thing. But here I suppose that the calls are related to one user, and the user has changed his phone number, and I want to assign his calls to the new phone. But the problem is that in that case, the calls were not really assigned to a phone, but assigned to a user. And maybe all my data model is wrong there. The calls should go to a user, and then the user has a phone or maybe multiple phones. So if you have this kind of question, think also about the data model. With surrogate key, everything is easy because you can update whatever you want in both cases. But easy doesn't mean that it's the right thing depending on the business. Easy is the flexibility to adapt to any business case. But, okay. I will go quickly on the next one because we have a lot of them and I wanted to do one only. Immutability also means that we need to know the primary key at object creation, which means at insert. And this is why a primary key is like another unique key, but with a not null. So you can create non-nullable unique keys, and that's the same, but that's also the idea. And there are cases where you don't know the value from the beginning. If you don't know the value from the beginning, then you need to assign a surrogate key, like a placeholder for something that you will add later. So the idea here is like you start to insert a phone, but you don't have the number yet. You wait for the activation, for example. And maybe the activation will be the first call, and maybe you will start to enter in the system the first call, and then afterwards assign a phone number. And then, of course, the natural key model doesn't fit because you cannot put a call there without knowing the phone number. And then in that case, so surrogate key must be introduced if the natural key is not known. Now, and at insert, we have seen that you can update a primary key, but there are problems if there are phone keys on them, but the primary key is non-nullable. Some other things related with performance as well. When you go to partitioning, you probably want to partition multiple tables on the same key. For example, if I want to partition my calls, because this is the large table, I may want to partition it on the prefix number of the phone number, for example, because the prefix is the company or is something where I want partitions. But in that case, if I have a surrogate key, I may want to partition the calls on an information that is not in the calls, the extension number. And that's not easy. Oracle can do that with referential partitioning. But that's not easy. It's, of course, easier if you have the information directly in the table. And when you use natural key, the nice thing is that you inherit the main information, the most important information from the table, and it's there, which means that with the natural key model, I can partition the calls on the phone prefix. Of course, not all tables have to be partitioned, but think about it. The main advantage of partitioning on the same key, a parent and child table, for example, think about orders and order items. When you join them, a lot of rows, you can do a hash join partition per partition, and then you save memory. We have seen performance because you have less joins and less indexes, and memory when you do some reporting on two tables if you can partition them on the same partition key, because it's a natural key, then it can save memory. You don't have to swap to disk for the join, and then it is faster. Okay, index overhead. We have seen that you need more indexes because any key must have an index to enforce it. You cannot ensure the unicity without a structure that can be hashed or sorted, but mainly an index. And then if I use only natural keys there, I have an index only on the natural keys. If I use a surrogate key, I need an index on the surrogate key, but I will probably still need to enforce the uniqueness of the business values. And then that's additional indexes. And you pay the price when you insert. You have to update all the indexes when you update or delete. In this document, I had also special value handling. Yeah, the problem comes, you should not have this case with a good model, but we all have seen data models where you have special values. For example, the date 9999 to say that it's not finished, or because you don't use nulls or anything. With a surrogate key, because you generate a value that has no business meaning, you can add values with more meanings. For example, here we have phone lines that are not real numbers, and I can generate a surrogate key for them. I will not look at the detail about this case. This is very important. If surrogate keys are visible to users, they become a natural key. Think about your social net security number, or for example, your national identity number, or the plate number on your car. Those are things that maybe are generated by the system, but they're exposed to the user. You see them in a card, in a form, in any document. And then as soon as it is exposed to the user uses it, and then it has a business meaning. And then even if you generated yourself as a surrogate key, it's not a surrogate key where you have all this agility to manage it, change it, or do whatever you want. So that's another thing. If you choose to add surrogate keys like there, do not put that, for example, if in the history of call from this user, I will not put the call ID there. I can use it for myself, to store, to have foreign keys, to maybe to order them if I'm sure about the sequence of it. But I do not show it to the user, so that it has a technical meaning only. Okay, little things also, some problems come. You have a lot of agility when you add a surrogate key because that's the value you generate. You do whatever you want with it. But imagine that you have to merge different systems, and that exists. For example, I live in Switzerland, and in Geneva recently, a lot of banks have merged, and then they had to merge their information system. If you have a natural key, this merge, for example, in the case of calls, there probably you merge two companies that have a different extension number, and then you can merge them, and that fits. If you generated an ID, you may have collisions, and then you have to do something else. So this agility helps in some way, but in other way, a natural key can help. And this is also where you may change a single column key to a multiple column key if I merge two companies. And let's say they have a surrogate key for the bank account numbers, for example. I merge them. Either I renumber everything, but that's quite impossible. Think about an update on terabyte of data, all rows with foreign keys. That's not possible. So if I want to merge them, but keep a key that is unique for each source, I can add a new colon, the company ID, before the merge. And then I have a composite key. This is also a case where we have composite keys, applications that are multi-company managed in one schema, for example. Okay, and that was also about the evolution, a company code, for example. And about composite key, now if I go back, yeah, that's what I explained. There is also something important on composite keys with the optimizer. The query planner has some information about the distribution of your data. And one information it has is the number of distinct value in a column. And from that, the optimizer can guess and have an estimation of the number of rows written by a predicate. If I have a natural key model and I query it on the natural keys, the optimizer will know how many extension number I have and will know how many prefix I have. So if I query where extension number is equal to something, the optimizer will probably have a good estimate on it. We have histograms, statistics on that. If I have a surrogate key there, this meaning of each attribute is lost. Where I had information about extension and prefix, now I have information about a number that covers both. And this is also a performance issue where you lose some information. It's very similar to the partitioning where you lose the information from the other table and there you lose some information. Of course, there are workarounds. You can also have more statistics or anything. But if you transform something that has a meaning with a composite key, for example, company and account number, the optimizer add statistics about companies and account numbers, and if you put just a UID on that, the optimizer cannot do any histograms to get an idea about the distribution of data within the values. So that's also something to take into account. Storage, of course, the rows will be larger if you add some columns, but that should not be a big problem today, except that if it's larger, you have more to fit in the cache, and of course, it's also a performance issue. Also, some data modeling tools do not support composite keys, but the problem is in the tools. In this case, you cannot create problems in your data model because of the tools. The data model should be there for the business meaning and for the performance of the business use cases. SQL complexity, all that, yeah. So finally, I think that this old document is still quite accurate. I've put the link there. Just think about it. I've written that some years ago. For example, Oracle didn't have referential partitioning at that time, I think. Also, something that I didn't mention, I will add a few minutes on that because it's quite important, because the question was coming from GPA Buddy, and it's about GPA, and that's a question I had a long time ago. People working with Hibernate telling me, oh, cannot use composite keys because Hibernate doesn't support it. And it supports it without any problem. In old versions of Hibernate, I think it was not so easy, but currently that's possible. And for that, the best information you can find on Hibernate is when you Google, you add Vlad, to get information from Vlad Michalsea. This is the blog, so I will put that in the chat, where Vlad explains how to map a composite key with JPA, and the idea is that you have two entities from the JPA mapping. You map the key as if it were another table, basically. So with embeddable, you define a class that covers only the ID. So this is the columns of the composite ID, and that's all. And then your table employee, instead of having just one attribute that is the primary key is the embedded ID there. And that's quite easy. And of course, I'm not a Java developer, but I did an example there just to show to the developers telling me, oh, I cannot use composite keys with JPA. Of course you can. If you had any problem, just tell me, but it's a lot of code, but anyway, this code is usually generated, and this is an example where I had generated all that. Embeddable, that's my primary key, so the business key becomes a class there, and then additional attributes on the whole objects. Okay, I will put this link in the chat as well. And I think we have covered a lot of things about that. For sure, I think that any tool working with databases can be ORM mapping, can be reverse engineering, can be anything. They must support composite keys. That doesn't mean that we have a lot of composite keys in the data model, but at least association table and other important table where, for performance reason, partitioning or anything, we prefer to use the natural key and compose key on that. But remember, even if you can do a lot because SQL is agile, a primary key, the goal of the primary key is to be immutable, known when you insert and doesn't change later. Okay, so the recording should be available on Twitch, and I will put it on YouTube probably, because on Twitch I think it stays a few days. I'm checking the chat to see if there are some comments about it, but I'm quite sure that people will watch the record later. Give me all the feedback about the topic or Twitch idea.
And of course, Twitter is where I like to get feedback. It's the easier, but you can contact me, find me on LinkedIn, anything. And yeah, let's say also you can find in Yugabyte community the Slack, for example, where you can interact or ask questions about specificities of Yugabyte. But of course, all what I've said there is related with SQL databases, with relational databases. Okay, I will stop the live now, and maybe I will do this other times. Maybe on topics like that, or when I will read a blog post or something like that, maybe I can share it. Thank you very much. I'm stopping the streaming now. Goodbye.